Welcome back to Idea Studio, where we look at life in Bangkok. I'm Dana.
I'm Jip.
And today, this is episode 4 of our Exploring Bangkok via BTS series. However, we're still in Samut Prakan at BTS Srinagarindra. I was really surprised by how local this was. And we were over walking on one of the klongs before. On the walkway, we ran into maybe a few too many dogs for your liking. Well, if we turn a little bit here, Jib, we can show them
the big tree.
This is such a green area. I was really surprised about how lush it is. It's the first thing you notice when you get off the BTS is how lush this area actually is. The walkway that we were on earlier when we first got here, we talked to one of the locals, well, Jib did, and he said that it goes for kilometers, but there are no roads. People are riding their motorcycle right on the walkway with no guardrail for the klong. So with that, guys, let's go explore BTS Srinagarindra. We start this journey here on Sukhumvit. The klong doesn't skirt the main road at this station. It splits off a ways down. But this one running perpendicular to Sukhumvit brings us through this small community to an interesting area in the back. You thought that was gonna be Jib, didn't you? This short klong ends at this flow control point, and it separates the one out of this community from the main klong and back. Before we get to the really cool part behind the klong, on the road between the little klong and the main one, we came across this old wooden house. It had this really cool design and a really cool vibe. On the other side of the main klong, there's this newer Chinese shrine. It's at the head of a path that skirts along the outside of the klong for kilometers and has houses along one side. Only a few minutes into the walk and we came across this rather large monitor lizard out for his afternoon swim. Being out on this path felt like you were 1,000 miles away from Bangkok. You're just surrounded by nature, despite the fact that Sukhumvit was less than a kilometer away. We spent about 30 minutes walking down this path and exploring, checking out some of the houses, but we had a few encounters with some really aggressive dogs. And at that point, we decided there was enough cool stuff to see in this neighborhood that we should probably give up on the path and go check out the rest of it. Walk back to Sukhumvit, we came across this old phone booth. My obsession with these continues. This day was particularly hot. So when we got back to Sukhumvit and came across this little cafe, we knew it was time to pop in for a cool caffeinated drink. Some iced coffee, perhaps. So refreshing. Time to cross Sukhumvit and explore what the other side of this BTS station has to offer. A vibe much more in line with what we had seen at other stations so far on this part of Sukhumvit. A very classic Thai neighborhood, a mix of houses and street vendors and little shops. We knew there was a temple out this way, and about 20 minutes into the walk on this side of Sukhumvit, we started to see it peeking over the trees and other houses. As we made our way closer, the road merged back with a klong, and that led us straight to the temple. This temple is a massive complex. Just entering the area is impressive. Let's go check it out. There's some interesting stuff in here. We're here at Wat Chai Mong Kong, and they have probably one of the best collections of Buddhist statues I've ever seen. Everything from characters from the Kong to monks to Buddhas. It really is an amazing collection. Really one of the biggest I've ever seen. Once we finish at the temple, we headed over to the little downtown neighborhood in this area. And even though there's a ton to see there, we were in a rush to get to the dock so that we could get over to the Julajung Plau Fort, which is sort of in the middle of the river, right at the mouth before the Gulf of Thailand. It's been turned into a national park. It's no longer really a naval fort, but it was the historic site of a battle between France and Thailand back in the 1800s. We'll get more into that when we get over there. So let's go. When we first leave the temple, we're in a very local neighborhood. But it doesn't take long for us to find our way to Samut Prakan's downtown area. This neighborhood has a ton of great cafes and restaurants, but we're on a mission to make it to the fort before it closes, so there's no time to waste. We head straight to the dock to get the ferry, which gives us a quick ride across the river. From the mainland to the island where the fort is located. We're here at the fort, and this is only like 4 feet tall, so I have to try to go under here. Let's go to the other side of the fort and check out. They have some cannons here. This is a Navy fort in the Chao Phraya. Let's go. Up out of these holes so they can defend the mouth of the Chao Phraya. It's actually a great design. So the cannons actually shot a 6-inch wide ball, and these were here to defend the mouth of the Chao Phraya, to defend Bangkok, and to defend Thailand for any fleet that was trying to come up the Chao Phraya and get access to Bangkok. They would stop them here in Samut Prakan. Okay, so we have to talk about the Proc Nam incident. This happened in 1893 when France sent two naval ships, a dispatch and a gunboat, to Bangkok, raid up the Chao Phraya through the Gulf to essentially pressure Thailand into resolving a dispute. Really, what they were trying to do was strong arm them into giving up some territory. When this all went down, France already had one gunship anchored in the Chao Phraya at their embassy in Bangkok, so it was a bit more than a slight flex. Now, the Siam Navy didn't want to let them up the Chao Phraya, but the French decided to play their colonizer white privilege card and go anyway. The thing is, the French had to know this would lead to conflict because they were well aware the Siam Navy, along with help from the Dutch, had just upgraded the fort and put these new guns in place at the mouth of the Chao Phraya to defend the city. So, with no surprise from anyone, a naval skirmish broke out once they tried to push through the blockade. The Thais fired some warning shots, the French kept going, then they started to engage. there's a little bit more to this that we have to break down. So as all of this is going down, the French dispatch is hit by a bunch of cannon fire and it's actually run aground. The gunship, however, makes it through the Siam defenses up to Bangkok, where it joins the other gunship. They aim their guns at the Grand Palace and they're saying that they want to force a resolution to these territorial disputes. Nothing clearly gets resolved at the time that this all went down, so France decides that they're going to now blockade the Chao Phraya, not allow shipping in and out. This really pisses off England because most of the trade at the time is with them. So they start to also pressure the government to make a deal with France and get this behind them. When all is said and done, the concessions that Thailand had to make for France invading them is to give up a bunch of territory east of the Mekong, basically what is today Laos, as well as they were forced to pay 3 million francs to France because France pushed their way up the river. This is a crazy interesting story. It's a really interesting time in Thailand's history, and I just wanted to add this context. I wasn't really aware when I visited the island with Jib, so I want to go and throw this back in. It'll most definitely be in a future video. I'll do a deeper dive on this. But for now, back to this video.
One of the more unique things that we found on the fort were these old barracks that have actually been turned into a shrine. And you can see where people leave these old dresses here. It's quite a unique sight. And of course, at sunset, there's no lack of amazing views on this fort. Definitely take some time to enjoy them.
Hope you enjoyed episode 4 that we explore around BTS Srinagarindra Station. And we're gonna wrap up here at the fort of Navy. So we will go back home before it's dark. Let's see you in the